Okay, so today I'm going to be talking on converting a nation. As Craig said, my research interests are very much... My research interests are on religious history, especially Reformation history, but I'm very much a social historian. I'm not a theologian, I'm not a Bible scholar, but I'm very much interested in how sort of religion intersects with people's lives. And this is what I'm focusing on today, is that task of converting a nation. But what I'll do is I'm going to start by giving you a little bit of background. I'm assuming that you don't all know how the Scottish Reformation happened. So I'll give you a little bit of background on that, and then I will start talking about the different ways over the last, 15 years or so that I've been doing my research on this question of how do they convert the religion of an entire nation. I'm going to give you little snippets from some of the different projects that I've looked at, and then hopefully they'll all kind of weave together and make a coherent story for you. And if you, I think we'll do questions at the end as the plan, so there'll definitely be some time for questions. Okay. So we have to start the Scottish Reformation with this lovely lady. Anybody know who she is? Yeah, Mary Stuart, Mary Queen of Scots. I can't help but be interactive. There's interactive components. Okay, I also have a trouble standing in one spot, so John, yell at me if I'm moving out of your spotlight, okay? Okay, so Mary Queen of Scots is born in 1542, and she succeeds to the throne at 6 days old. Her father dies immediately after her birth. And this basically makes her a very vulnerable monarch because she's a child, she's a woman, and she's a really good strategic marriage for a lot of different people, in particular Henry VIII's son. And Henry VIII comes into Scotland, and there's a period that historians have said it's called the Rough Wooing, where they basically tried to kidnap her so that they could force her to marry his son. And the Scottish nobles were successful in kind of keeping her away from the grasp of the English. And in 1648, she was sent to France, where she was to be engaged to the Dauphin, or the heir to the French throne, Francis. He would become Francis II of France. The reason why this French connection is there is that her mother was Mary de Guise, and so she's from one of the most powerful of the French noble families. And this was a great match for her. And so she was raised in France. This is important. She was raised with French language, French culture and customs. She was raised to be queen consort. And this is important for the Scottish Reformation because the Scots were a little worried about just being taken over by the much more powerful and wealthy French monarchy. So while she was away in France, there were a number of regents towards the end of her her time away from Scotland. Her mother was her regent, so she ran the country on her behalf. But Mary de Guise had to deal with some of the new reforming ideas that were coming from the continent and filtering their way into Scotland. So George Wishart is one of the early reformers in the 1540s. He is influenced by Calvinism in particular. And he basically goes on a tour of Scotland preaching the new ideas, and in 1546 he is arrested and tried as a heretic by Cardinal Beaton and in St. Andrews. And St. Andrews was the spiritual home of Scotland for the previous many hundreds of years. And when he was tried as a heretic, he was found guilty and he was hung on a gibbet and his body was burned. And when that happened, many of his followers were quite upset and they struck a plan to have retribution for the death of Wishart. And they had a multi sort of pronged approach where they decided they were going to invade St. Andrew's Castle and murder Beaton. And so some of them sort of broke in the back door, others made a proper appointment to come and see him. They didn't know what he was getting into. There's only two or three of them. Another group dressed as masons, because there's some work being done on the castle, and they all kind of converged in different areas, and they ended up stabbing Beaton to death. And when they did that, then of course they faced, treasonous sort of charges. And so they took control of the castle, and for 18 months they were in the castle and they held it. And siege, there was siege warfare. You go to St. Andrews, don't miss that. Don't just go to the golf course. Go to St. Andrews Castle as well, because it's kind of cool, because they have this trench warfare where they're like digging underneath the walls and you can still go into these tunnels and stuff. It's a cool place to go. But what's important, why I say this, is because one of those followers is this guy right here, John Knox. So John Knox was in the castle. He was one of the conspirators. And when the French sent in their navy and their superior military power, and basically through massive bombardment took back the castle, many of them were arrested and sent to be slaves on or galleys in France. And so John Knox was one of those people, and he was sent off into France to be a slave on the slave galleys. And when he was done that punishment, he went to England in 1549. He wasn't in a hurry to go back to Scotland. So he went to England, which was undergoing a reformation as well. And everything seemed like it was going to be okay until the monarch dies. And it was Edward VI, who was a Protestant. When he died, his sister inherited the throne. And she's come down to us in history as Bloody Mary, right? She's the Catholic Tudor, Mary Tudor. You can debate about whether or not she really deserves the title Bloody Mary or not. But so in 1553, he was forced again to leave Britain and go back to the continent. And there he went to Geneva, where he met with John Calvin and a number of the most important of the Calvinist reformers in Geneva and Switzerland. And he, by this point, was very sort of, reinforced. He'd been through a lot for his religion. He'd been through a lot for his convictions. And he was very much a strong Calvinist supporter. And he came back in 1558. So this is when Mary Tudor dies. At first he lands in England, and then he decides, well, I'm actually going to go right up to Scotland. It's ready for my home country. It's time for my home country to convert. So he goes in, and this is about the same time that, Mary of Guise is running the country. The queen is away in France. She seems like she's going to, she's in 1558. She actually marries Francis II. They're 17 years old. And it looks like Scotland is going to come under the control of the French. The Scottish nobles were not so keen on this. So as with most of the Reformation events that happened in the 16th century, religion is deeply entwined with political happenings. And so there was, a political motivation for the Scottish lords to convert to Protestantism. Doesn't mean that many of them weren't deep and ardent believers, but they also have political motivation. And they wanted to be distinct from their monarch. They wanted to be distinct from the Catholic monarchies of France. So in 1559, Knox, with a lot of his supporters, and many of them were nobles, they're the lords of the congregation, they're known as, they undertake a massive conversion effort, and they go into places like Perth and St. Andrews, and they literally, overnight, they kind of walk in, march into town in the morning, they're clanging their pots and they're yelling, and they go through the town and they follow sort of Calvinist iconoclasm, so they go into all of the Catholic, the monasteries and the churches, the cathedral, and they smash all of the iconography, so all of the stained glass and that sort of a thing. There's a head that was found at the bottom of a latrine in an archaeological dig, so they're throwing, and that was the head of Christ that they threw down the toilet. So they're making a lot of statements. And by the end of that day, and they railed their ministrations from the pulpits, and they did all these things. And by the end of the day, much of the population had converted. So they literally woke up Catholic and went to bed Calvinist, which is very strange. Now Knox was like, this is great. This conversion is going to be very easy for me. I can make this Reformation happen. It worked in three cities, but after that, it was much more challenging because, of course, Catholicism was deeply ingrained in the belief system and the culture of the people, and so it became much more challenging. So this is just St. Andrews on the left-hand side. And it's fallen into ruins, right? Because that was the spiritual home of Catholicism. There's been no need in Scotland to keep that going. So it's just in ruins. Oh, one of the other things they do, this is just a picture I have from St. Nicholas Church in Dalkeith. The other thing is, if they couldn't actually smash the Catholic icons and Catholic, what they saw as superstitious elements of the religion. They would just brick them over. So the spiscina, which is where they ritually clean, like the communion cup and that sort of thing, they just bricked it over. So even when they go into churches now and they do renovations, they often find a lot of the elements of Catholic churches behind brick walls and that sort of thing. So John Knox gets together with five other really strong Calvinist reformers. They all have the first name John, so they're known as the Six Johns. I forgot to tell you, Mary Queen of Scots, when she went to France, she had four maids that came with her, and they were the Marys, the four Marys. They're not very creative with their names. But so the Reformation Parliament happens in 1559. So Calvin and the Six Johns, they get together, or the five Johns, there's six of them together. They get together, and they write something that has come down to us as the Scots Confession. And basically what this is the tenets of the Calvinist faith and how it's going to be implemented in Scotland. And basically, it's a plan for converting the nation. It's not that big, so, you know, it's not that extensive. It's just the framework for doing so. And in Parliament, when the 1559-60 session met, they accepted it. It was brought into legislation, and Parliament literally said, okay, nation, you're converting. And that's what's always sort of triggered my imagination. How do you do that? Okay, that's nice that, you know, you've got Knox and he's running around in different communities and that's great. But, you know, can Parliament just tell you, you know, what to do with your religion? If, you know, dare I say it in Southern Alberta, if Trudeau told us to convert our religion, would we all do it? No, probably not. So how did they actually go about this? And this is what I'm going to talk about as I go through. So first I want to talk a little bit about what some of the aspects of Calvinism are that I'm going to be referring to as we go through, so that makes a bit sense. So one of the things is that everything exists for the glory of God. Now all humans are sinners. It's an inescapable inheritance from the Garden of Eden. This is not something that humans can sort of avoid. We're all sinners. But, and this is what's quite Calvinist about it, is that God's great mercy, by his great mercy, he has chosen, despite the sin, that some people will be chosen to be saved. And that is sometimes, it's referred to as election or maybe predestination. Now for the Scots, they felt that they were particularly looked upon by God or favored by God. So it doesn't mean that all the Scots are going to be elect or chosen, but that they were particularly favored by God. And as such, in the Scots Confession, they had to plan a well-ordered and regulated church that would reflect well upon the glory of God and upon their chosen position. And they called this the godly community. So they're going to create a godly community of Scots. And to create a godly community, it had basically a two-pronged attack. One was to repress vice, so get rid of sin. Because that's, you know, sin's going to happen, yeah, we're all sinners, and, you know, it's going to happen, but we need to make sure that there's not too much of it. And that, yeah, I'll get to the sin in a minute. So there's not too much of it. And if you are sinful, that you repent for your sins and that you show, you know, that you want to be brought back into the godly community. The other thing is to nourish virtue. So it seems like it's the flip side of the vice, but it's also to nourish that virtue, to internalize the new religion, to make this your belief system. Now, I have this little chart that I've got because one of the ways that they do this is through creating a church court system. So on the bottom, I have the Kirk sessions. Those are the local moral church courts. And the local moral church courts, they typically meet once a week, or they're supposed to meet once a week. Depends on how good they're following this. But they meet once a week. And basically, they are charged with a whole bunch of different things. They have to seek out sin in the community and have people be accountable for the sin. So they literally are tasked with listening to gossip and peeking in people's windows to see what's going on in people's houses. They also are tasked with going and visiting people in their homes to see if they are learning, their religious lessons, their catechism. Can they say the Lord's Prayer? Do they know the Ten Commandments? Can they say the Apostles' Creed? All of those different things. So making sure of this. They also dole out charity, because charity is a key aspect in this society as well. So those are the local, sort of at the parish level, the Kirk Sessions. The presbyteries are sort of a regional amalgamation of Kirk Sessions, and there might be like 5 or 6 Kirk Sessions that meet together as a presbytery. And when they couldn't deal with things at a parish level, so maybe the local lord just isn't listening to the minister, they might bring them up to the presbytery level. The synods are even larger regions, and the General Assembly is also known as the Universal Kirk, or it's the National Assembly. And the National Assembly has representatives from the Kirks, so they're ministers and elders, but they also have lords of the congregation, so nobles, the king himself is a member of the General Assembly. And so basically, at a national level, they'll deal with anything that really they couldn't deal with at the other levels. But they also come up with sort of national policies. So the Kirk Session records that I'm going to refer to, so they're the local moral courts. Every time they meet every week, they keep records, which are the sources that I look at a lot. And they deal with things, all sorts of sins. And the General Assembly will say, you know, what the fines for those should be, what sort of punishment should happen, and that sort of a thing. So that's what the General Assembly does. Now, why did I get involved with this? I just have to tell this because it's kind of the Kirk Session records. When I went to do my master's degree, I had no interest in Scotland. I never really thought about it. And then I got connected with a supervisor who said, well, you really like religious history, you really like social history, maybe these moral courts where you see people sinning all the time will tell you a little bit about how religion and people come together. Why don't you take a look at them and see what you think? So I read for about a half an hour, and I came across a case where a wife had actually brought her husband before the Kirk, and it was her complaint was that they had not been in bed together for 12 years. And the session said, well, that's not right. You know, your duty is to keep your wife happy and so that you guys can be a strong family unit and you can teach religion to your children and we can all be a harmonious community. So within the next 48 hours, the husband and the wife are to be reunified. And next week when we meet, the wife and all of your neighbors are supposed to come to the session to tell us that this has happened. So I was like, this is interesting. So I might be able to read more of these. So the Kirk Session records. That's one of the better ones. But there are some really good ones. But they tell you a lot about religion and about how religion is being implemented. Okay, here's an interactive part. So this is what the Kirk Session records actually look like. So I just like to give people an idea about the records that I'm reading. So interactively, can anybody read any of that? No? If you want to learn paleography from the early modern period, from the 16th century, this is a great website, and I'll take you through tutorials, and it's actually quite a lot of fun. So I can't really read where I'm standing. So I've got, the said day, certain persons charged before the assembly for playing, dancing, and singing filthy carols on Yule Day, at evening and on Sunday evening. Therefore, the witch persons come and granted their fault and was punished for their sinning, their names are following. And so it's listing. So basically what's going on in this particular record is that people had been out singing Christmas carols, which is a real problem for the Kirk because to them, Yule celebrations were based in pagan traditions. And when Catholicism was brought, when Europe was Christianized, a lot of traditions of the Catholic Church were brought in alongside of pagan traditions, and for the Calvinists, they saw that as being what they would have referred to as popish. It's also Catholic, which they don't like. So they want to get rid of that. They also don't like dancing and singing because they don't think that that's very godly. Unless you're singing psalms, that's okay. But the other thing about the Yule is that often it was, they would go to people's houses and you don't just sing a carol, but you expect a drink in return. So that's like one of the records that they're going through. Okay, so there's all sorts of official Kirk policies where they're like actively setting out to try to convert the population. So the ministers, I like this one, this is in St. Andrew's Castle. It's a mocking up of John Knox as he's reeling from the pulpit. And they are impassioned, like they are so impassioned, these ministers. You know, it's fire and brimstone and it's, but it's also inspiring, right? There's all sorts of things that they're saying from the pulpits. So of course, daily or Sunday sermons are really, really important. And in places like Edinburgh, they would have multiple sermons throughout the week. And in fact, the National Kirk, the General Assembly, institutes that you are supposed to go to Sunday before lunch and after lunch on Sunday, so you get two sermons. So that's, you know, so the sermons are really, really important. They're one way of getting a message across, and that's an official sort of way. The other thing that they do, is that they institute discipline. So the Kirk sessions, fine, they sort of suss out the sinners. Now what do you do with them? Well, you might give them a monetary fine, but the other thing that you do is you have them show their repentance for their sin, because remember, everybody's a sinner. And so the way, though, that doesn't negate that you might be one of the elect, because everybody's a sinner. So if, you know, God has chosen you by his divine grace, you will come back to the religion, and you will do that through discipline. And so one of the things they would do is they would make you sort of publicly show your repentance. So the Kirk Session records are sometimes referred to as the fornication records, because there's an awful lot of premarital sex going on that they're really, really worried about, especially because in this time period, women don't marry until their mid-20s and men until their late 20s. And they also, a lot of them circulate in service and live in other people's houses. And so they're not even living at home under their parents' supervision. So they're quite concerned about young people and what they're doing. They're quite concerned about it. So if you were charged with fornication, you would often have to spend 3 Sundays on the stool of repentance. And so this is a stool of repentance right here. And basically what happens is the minister's pulpit is quite high at the front of the church because it's about the word of God, right? Everybody wants to hear the word of God. This is quite a switch from the medieval Catholic church where everything was in Latin and people didn't understand what was going on. The rituals were behind a screen. But in the Calvinist faith, it's about reading the Bible, learning about the word of God. And so the minister would be up there railing from his pulpit, and you would be just below him. And so the whole congregation would be watching you for that whole Sunday on the stool of repentance. So that's a high stool of repentance. I don't have permission to show you a low stool of repentance. The fornicators would usually be on the low stool of repentance. An adulterer would be on the high stool of repentance. So the higher you got, the more horrible your sin was in the eyes of the church. Oh, that's the stool of repentance. There we go. So they may also make you wear sackcloth while you do that. So you have to go, the Scots wording is that you would go bareheaded, barefooted, and bare-legged before the congregation. You would stand at the church door while everybody filed in, and then you would be brought before the congregation, and you would be put in your sackcloth on a stool of repentance. So if you had sackcloth on top of it, it was probably even a worse crime. Or worse sin, I should say. It's not a crime, really. So discipline. And once you had shown your true repentance, you couldn't be up there giggling because then they'd make you do it all over again. But if you had really shown your true repentance for your sin, you would be welcomed back into the godly community. Now, I forgot about the slide. It seemed like a good idea at the time. Okay, so this is the sort of public shaming is something that was within the context of the time period as well. So this is a toll booth, which is sort of the administrative center of a Scottish town during the time period. You would go there to pay your taxes. You would go there to, I don't know, do whatever you needed to do that you would do right here, actually. And so you would go for those different things. But it's also the prison. They don't have, you know, long-term prisons. And they might put you in the jugs, which are what I'm pointing to right there. And one of the jugs is right here. You can't probably see it. And then there's another one lower down. And they would put you, it's an iron hinge collar, and you would be chained to the wall of the toll booth. Or churches have them as well. You might be chained to the wall of the church. And so that everybody could see you when they went by, and you might be there for a half a day or a couple of hours or whatever it is that the punishment is that they instituted. So, you know, this discipline might seem really odd, but it's actually within sort of the realm of all of the other types of punishments that they might have outside of the church. The other really big official beyond discipline and the sermons that the church did was education. They're very, very interested in education. So the six Johns who wrote the first book of discipline in 1561, which was not officially adopted by Parliament, so it wasn't widely accepted. The second book of discipline was, that was about a decade later. But basically what it does is it sets out what the discipline's gonna look like, why this discipline has to happen, but they also have a really big section on education. And so of necessity, it is that your honors be most careful for the virtuous education and godly upbringing of the youth of this realm. If either ye now thirst unfeignedly the advancement of Christ's glory, or yet desire the continuance of his benefits to the generation following, for as the youth must succeed to us, so we ought to be careful that they have knowledge and erudition to profit and comfort that which ought to be most dear to us, to wit, the Kirk and spouse of our Lord Jesus. So basically, if you want your children to embrace the word of God as a Calvinist, then we need to educate them that way. So they came up with a plan of creating schools for every town. And it took them 200-300 years to do it, but they had a plan. And so education was really important. Universities were part of that, but also family education. In the household, fathers and mothers were supposed to be teaching the religion and teaching the catechism to their children as they're going through, and they examine them on this to make sure that these things had actually happened. And so education is critical. If you're going to convert the belief system of a nation, you have to get at the young people. So those are the really sort of obvious official policies of the church. But there's a lot of other things that are going on when you read through the session records and you read some of the sermons ministers and other religious writings that have happened during the time period. And you begin to realize that there's a lot of other things that need to shift as well. So there needs to be cultural shifts. And there also needs to be shifts in identity. So one of the things that they're quite concerned about are the way that people spend their time. So this is a subsistence world. People work from sunup to sundown. They have very little time to themselves. Sundays are a day of rest, but you're in sermons before lunch and after lunch, and then when you go home, you're supposed to talk about the sermons with your family. There's not a whole lot of time for you to do your own thing. Some of the young people, especially those who are out in service, who are living in other people's houses, they might have a few hours at night, but for the most part, they're all pretty busy just surviving. And so what they want to do is they want to make sure that when people do find leisure time, that they're going to be acting in a godly way. So one of the first things that they go after, I'm going to just give you a few examples. I could go on and on and on about this, but I'm going to give you a few examples. So one of the things that they go after are penny bridals. So penny bridals are wedding ceremonies. Not ceremonies, wedding celebrations. The ceremony they've gotten in the Book of Discipline, it's all set up for them. But the penny bridals basically are when you would have your wedding celebrations. So you would collect a set amount of money from each of your guests, and that would pay for the food, it would pay for the alcohol, and it would pay for the fiddler or the piper in Scotland. And so you could have a really good party based on the money that they brought for you. And these community celebrations are really important, sort of time of celebration, but they're also, you know, what people do with their spare time. Everybody looks forward to a good wedding in the community. Now, the Kirk was not so crazy about the penny bridals, because when you're drinking and dancing, sometimes things get a little out of hand. So they were quite concerned about these different things. The General Assembly took the lead in issuing decrees that would uphold the godly community at such celebrations. In 1610, it is statute and ordained by the whole assembly that the celebration and solemnization of the holy bed of matrimony be performed with Christian modesty and without all disorder. On the 10th of May, 1635, they're still not listening. The Kirk Session of Galston argued that minstrels and pipers who are at bridals are oftentimes the cause of fighting and jars falling out among the people. Therefore, the session has concluded that all pipers, fiddlers, and other minstrels be discharged from bridles in time to come. So those fiddlers, there's so much trouble. Get rid of them and the pipers. The Kirk session of Humby explains it in a bit more detail. What's up with all these penny bridles? Why are they so worried about it? So piping and dancing before and after dinner or supper, and the staying of persons convened for drinking, the dinner and supper being ended, occasions great lasciviousness. Moreover, that loose speeches and filthy communication and singing of body songs and profane minstreling in time of dinner or supper tends to great debauchery. Penny bridles, in our judgment, become seminaries of all profanation within our bounds. So, it's not good, right? if you're trying to bring about a godly community, things are not going to go well in the penny bridles. And in fact, the Kirk session goes on to say that such behavior was to the great dishonor of God, the scandal of our Christian profession, and prejudice of the country's welfare. In fact, if you continue in this way, God might punish you. He might send a plague, he might send a famine, he might do anything, because he is not happy that, you know, this is how you are behaving. And I love this image. This is a painting in a lowland wedding or a village dance after De Witt's. It's in the 17th century. And basically, this is a commentary about what happens in if you let penny bridles go on. And at first, it just kind of looks like there's a party going on. But if you start to look at what everybody's doing in the party, so here's likely the bride and the groom dancing. Out front, there's a dog with a bone. There's always dogs with bones in all the early modern paintings. But there's a young man with a pipe smoking tobacco. That's not good. There is, on the top left, oh, you know what, I might have a thing. There we go. There's somebody who's really drunk riding off into the night with their arms flung back. Like, who knows what they're going to go do. Down here's the minister and his wife sort of looking very disapprovingly of what's going on in front of them. Here is a, you can just kind of see this, but what's actually going on here is that there's a woman holding the head of someone who's vomiting from excess alcohol. Here there are two boys fighting and they've got to break them apart, you know, it's like violence and chaos, all these different things are happening. And this is the most scandalous of it all. So here's a pregnant woman and she's standing beside her husband, and beside her is a young man who's seducing her. And so, you know, the insinuation is who even knows where, you know, that baby came from. And so, you know, this is what they feel is going on if you allow these things to happen. And that's definitely not good for the godly community, right? This is not what they want to be doing. So they're even, so they try to change these cultural practices, even down to the way in which they consume food is tied up with all of this sin and misbehavior. So reformers tried to limit the perceived damages done by banqueting. Initially, they tried to outlaw banquets altogether, and not just penny bridles, but other types as well. We'll talk about it. In 1583, the Kirk Session of St. Mungo's in Glasgow would statute and ordain that there be no superfluous banqueting oath in making of marriage or the baptism of barons. Also a bad place. There's always alcohol and food happening at baptisms. So this is quite concerning. And people have to pay 20 shillings as a deposit. And if anybody transgresses at their baptism or their child's baptism or at a wedding, they have to forfeit that fine. Over time, the reformers found that despite their deterrence and disapproval, that baptisms, marriages, and yes, even burials, were imbued with such social significance that the Reformed teachings did not prevail. So people, even at weddings or at funerals, I'll get to in a second, came together with drink. Within the community, these events were essential to the recognition, celebration, and the legitimation of a person's shifting role from one stage of the life course to the next. Diana O'Hara even argues that in England, feasts could play an important role in diffusing familial tensions that could emerge from these shifting relationships. the cultural significance of feasting was so powerful that it would prevail within the culture of Protestantism. And in fact, it's pretty much the only leisure time that they get. They're not allowed to participate in any of the Saints' Day celebrations anymore. They can't participate in Yule or Midsummer's Eve or any of the different things that they used to be able to participate in. So to take away from them these really important familial celebrations was just too much. Therefore, reformers developed new tactics that were geared towards controlling the details of the celebrations. They can't get rid of them altogether. They want to hope that participants would be less likely to imbibe in excesses which threaten the godly community. So in Galston, hostelers, which are innkeepers, were subject to fines if they hosted large public celebrations by providing meat and drink to participants, and also alcohol, that assumes. The hostelers objected to this decree, arguing that they were not allowed to host bridal, burial, and baptismal dinners, then they would be forced out of business, and this would seriously impede the financial stability of the area and affect the poor whose charity their business supported. This argument appeared to work as the session rescinded the directive. They were allowed to continue hosting those events. Other restrictions included limiting the number of people allowed to congregate for celebrations. The hope was that with lowered attendance, the accompanying sin and disorder would be muted. The Presbytery of St. Andrews ordered those who have the dead in their houses before the burial should give no entrance to the confused multitude who frequent such occasions, and instead invite only three or four grave kinfolk or friends, some real mourners only, no, none of the partiers. And it is not a time of eating or drinking or making merry after a worldly manner, they say. The previous year, the same presbytery passed an act for penny bridals, baptisms, and contracts, and contracts are basically when marriage contracts are signed, so there's also sort of like an engagement party type of a thing. Because of the great abuse that is likewise among them by convening multitudes of baptisms and contracts, the ministers and sessions are appointed to take strict order for restraining these abuses, that in number they not exceed six or seven. In 1625, the town council of Aberdeen restricted both the number of people allowed to participate in the various celebrations connected to baptisms, as well as strictly forbidding all extravagances at table. So again, you can't have these huge feasts because if you're feasting, you're probably drinking, and they try to control all of these different things. So the popular culture, the popular celebrations are very much limited. Now, another thing that they do is identity. And one of the types of identity I'm going to talk about now is gender identity. So sex being you're a male or female, but gender being sort of what it is to be feminine or what it is to be masculine. And the reformers work really hard to sort of make femininity and masculinity something that adheres to reformed ideals. And so I'm going to deal first with femininity. I'll get back to my skinny minister. He's so great. So within the broader continental context, historian Lyndall Roper argues that the early 16th century Reformation is often viewed as both a religious credo and a social movement, but it must be understood also as a theology of gender. Reformed femininity was interesting. Women were to be maternal, pious, submissive, and faithful. Sometimes these traits came into conflict with one another, so I'm just going to give you one example of that. In Catherine Hamilton's memoirs, she wrote that her daughter Anne, quote, was a very hopefully lovely child on whom I confess I set my heart too much. When the child fell ill, Catherine was much grieved, quote, for I loved my child dearly. The great torment and agony that I saw my poor child in made me go oftener to God than I was wont to do. Initially, Catherine blamed God for being cruel and wanted to know if he was punishing her. She believed that Anne could not have actively offended him. Catherine begged God to torture her instead or to let Anne die and end the torment. With Anne's death at 14 months of age, Catherine came to terms with the situation, believing, she writes, that it had been a sin to love the child so much. She believed that the whole situation had been a spiritual lesson that could only have been taught to her in this way. So her maternal femininity is in conflict with the piety and her sort of focus on developing her relationship with God. They had conflicted, and she realizes in the end that it was her religious lesson. This is a 17th century evangelical Scots perspective on parenting. It demonstrates a complex relationship between parents, children, and religion. Catherine Hamilton's final conviction followed the beliefs of others of the same ilk. Children were given to parents by God for specific reasons, and as a result, they were obligated to raise their children in accordance with his wishes. In late 16th and 17th century Scotland, the National Kirk believed that God's wishes were for parents to help ensure the success of the Reformation. To achieve the godly community of Scots, laid out in that 1560 Scots Confession, the Scottish population had to be wholly subjected to the Reformed ideals by tapping into what Susan Karen Newton terms the local and personal religious processes. As families were the building blocks of communities and communities of society, the Kirk turned to this important social institution for support in bringing about the individual internalization of Reformed values and to enforce public and private behavior that reflected positively upon God's chosen community. To be a good mother meant that you were maternal and pious, but that you were also submissive to the expectations placed upon you by God and the Kirk. So that's women. What about men? What about masculinity? As with gender ideals more generally, masculine piety was active and authoritative. They're in control, they're in charge, while feminine piety, as I just talked about, was more submissive and obedient. Reformed masculinity was essential to the success of the Reformed agenda in Scotland. In his 1589, A Spiritual Propine of a Pastor to His People, Minister James Melville explained how this model would bring reformation to the entire realm. So if you're a good reformed man in charge of your household, reverend fathers, and loving brethren of the eldership, mindful of the weight of your charge and of the solemn oath and obligation made before God, his angels and Kirk relating to that matter, take faithful and diligent care that this word of life dwell plentifully, first in your own hearts, and next in your families, from which, as fountains of living waters, it may flow unto the hearts, houses, and families committed in particular to every one of your charge. Within Scotland, the ideal of the Reformed man consisted of a number of traits and attributes, all of which were intended to further the Reformed cause. By internalizing the faith and encouraging those in their families to do the same, male heads of households contributed to the domestication of the Reformation. Ministers offered the male model of personal piety, order and control over one's household, seriousness of mind, frugality, humility, temperate drinking, chastity outside of marriage, trustworthiness, self-discipline, and, interestingly, despite their authority, submissiveness to the Kirk. Through these personal traits, individuals would create a pious community and one where individual behavior reflected the goals of the godly community. So I've got just a couple examples I want to talk about. So drinking is an important aspect of masculinity in the early modern period. This is where, you know, over a pint is where people had business deals done. It's always at the tavern where business deals were sort of covered. It's also, you know, a way to sort of create relationships and camaraderie because, you know, alcohol is a bit of a social lubricant. Your defenses are down a little bit, right? You get to know people better. So this created ties and bonds in the community where people really relied on each other to survive. And so this is something that's very important. But in the Reformed Church, it had to be done in moderation. Previously, or in maybe more popular ideas of drinking culture, your ability to hold your liquor was good. That showed your masculinity. But in the Reformed Church, that's not what they want. You can have a drink or two, but it must be moderate. It must be temperate. And in particular, because drinking often happens when you're getting together for leisure activities too. If you're gambling, doing dicing, or they were really big into betting on cockfights, or dice playing, all of these different things, that they could get really out of control if there's too much alcohol. So, of course, that threatens the godly community. So they're quite concerned about all of those different things. Another thing is clothing. So clothing is an indication of the internalization of the faith of men and women. Clothing was an outer representation of the seriousness with which one embraced the reforming cause. Ministers and those serving in the function of the Kirk were held up as models for the rest of the community. So models, ministers were to model this reformed masculinity. And then they were to take it to their families, and then the rest of the men in the community were to take it to their families. So ministers and those serving in the function of the Kirk were to make appropriate choices in apparel. In 1575, the General Assembly, so that national Kirk, outlined what was acceptable clothing. Accessories and colors for ministers, readers, so readers of the sermons, and their wives to wear. So quote, that the good word of God be not slandered by them and their immoderateness, and their wives to be subject to the same order. In addition to avoiding rich fabrics such as silk, velvet, and taffeta, those in positions of power within the Kirk were to avoid costly ornamentation, such as extravagant embroidery or passements, which are lace or braided adornments. The wearing of rings or gold, silver, or metal buttons was also discouraged, as was the expensive gilding of knives and wingers, which are the short swords all the men wore their daily apparel, and the excessive use of fabric, such as in doublets, and so doublets are when they slash the material and pull the extra material through. The wearing of red, blue, or yellow was to be avoided, as it suggested a lightness of mind. Instead, it was recommended to ministers and their wives that, quote, their whole habit be of a grave color, such as black, russet, sad gray, or sad brown. So clothing embodied the inner life of a reformed person, a piety that resulted in seriousness of mind, frugality, and humility. It was critical to the reformed cause that ministers modeled this trait. The stakes were high, as those who wore gorgeous and vain apparel, as they say, attracted the wrath of God. And in 1596, those wearing really nice clothes were even blamed for contributing to the famine that hit that year. So this is the reformed minister, who I just love him. He's really famous. Here's a minister. He's looking like he's trying to have some fun, but he's not. I don't know. He's very serious of mind, I guess, is what he's doing. So he's achieving that, but he's setting out that model for everybody else. So this discussion has been about thinking like a humanist. So what is a humanist? History is part of the humanities. We talk about the humanities, you hear them slagged in the media all the time. Nobody needs to study the humanities. And basically the humanities are history, English, religious studies, languages, what am I missing? Philosophy, am I missing any? And they are a deep and penetrating study of what it is to be a human. So why do people do the things that we do? What are our shared experiences? How do we get to the point that we do? How can we understand how people act and react to situations? And so by studying, you know, how do you convert an entire nation, you have to look at it in a multiple and complex ways, right? There's a history behind it. There's political, it's not just about faith and belief and ideas, but there's political implications that are involved in this. There's an official line that exists from the Kirk, but there's also a lot of subtleties that are happening. These messages, people are being bombarded with these messages about how they should act, what their identity should be, how they should think, how they should behave. And so that's what it is to think as a humanist, is to look at some sort of major historical event, historical change, or a culture, or whatever it is that you're looking at about human beings, and to understand the multiple complex and contributing factors that get you to how you are, where you are. And so that's what I would say, thinking like humanists. So I just thought I'd throw that in there. And just a quick little acknowledgement, there's been various funders because this has been going on forever. So thanks to the funders, thanks to the National Museums of Scotland for some of their image permissions, and to the Faculty of Arts and Science for hosting the fantastic public professor series. So thank you for listening to me tonight.